The Welsh taxi driver killed taking a miner to work.
As the solidarity broke down, miner turned on miner, with tragic results. There was widespread outrage after strikers dropped a concrete block onto a taxi carrying working miners to their pit. The miner survived, but the driver was killed.
It is for accident. I think the public opinion went down, and which is obvious it's going to go down. When there's a life being lost like that.
Attacks on working miners, many in their own homes, reached a new pitch of frenzy. Mrs. Thatcher's ardent supporter, Sun editor Kelvin McKenzie, saw the hand of revolutionaries at work. He decided to send in his own agent to unmask them.
So if we put somebody in as a miner, into the miner's side anyway, you can actually get the real sense of what's happening in a dispute. Baby, I'm
your man. Kelvin ordered Sun reporter Richard Ellis to go undercover amongst the strikers.
I remember distinctly him marching up and down in his office. He couldn't keep still, could never keep still, particularly when he was doing something like this. He'd be marching back and forth, saying, got to do this, got to get into them, got to infiltrate these you know, we've got to show them.
Two previous attempts by the Sun to infiltrate the miners had failed. So Richard changed his identity, grew a beard, became an unemployed labourer, and joined the Socialist Workers' Party. After a few weeks, he was sent to a picket line in Lancashire. What he found showed that the miners didn't need any incitement from the far left.
It was eye-opening, absolutely eye-opening and quite frightening.
Here the strikers have devised new tactics, Operation Surveillance. A posse of cars is waiting to tail and spot the working miners.
What became obvious after a few days there, that they had organised themselves into small kind of hit squads, flying, not flying pickets, but more flying attackers.
It's imperative that we don't blow our cover on this first leg, because up to now we've spotted four scabs, and four scabs who we can name.
They would target those people who had either gone back to work or were shaky, preparing to go back to work, and they would literally go and intimidate or beat up that person to stop that. They didn't need left-wingers from London to do that. They were perfectly capable of doing themselves.
This is a coward's way, isn't it? This is a coward's way. Why don't you come and beat fellas up in daylight?
Not
one at a time, one man to one man.
How many?
Not like it's been up bloody telly this morning where six men broke into a blockhouse and braided with bleeding sticks.
The miners' leader launched his own vicious verbal attack on the strikebreakers. Much of the worst violence was focused on the working miners' leaders and their families.
We had loads of threats. We had threats on Colette's life, which for anyone that's got kiddies knows that's not nice. Then one day in particular, I remember, Colette came through to the kitchen and said, Mum, there's loads of people, loads of men on the lane.
Got a phone call from one of the neighbours saying that there were about 80 or so pickets outside our house.
I put my girls into the kitchen with the dog because I knew that nobody would get through the door with the dog. And I'm getting a bit shaky talking about this, aren't I? I can feel it. And I stayed in the hallway to the door where the pickets was outside. And I knew that they wouldn't get past me either.
Now, my first thoughts were, you know, Sheila and the kids are in there. So I ran out through the pit gates, right through the picket lines again.
I saw our car pulling into the drive. I didn't know at the time, but one of our neighbours had rung down to the pit, told me what was happening, which I never thought to do. And he came up the lane, and because they wouldn't move, there were quite a few of them come down on the bonnet of the car into the drive.
I got a small escort at the time. I drive a Range Rover now, and I've prayed to God many a time that I'd got that Range Rover then, because I'd have got a dozen of the swines on the bonnet, and they deserved it. They were terrorising two young kids in ours, and my wife.
Time can never mend the careless whispers.
The Grey Trex's experience was familiar to Richard Ellis, the Sun's undercover reporter. He'd been on picket lines in Lancashire for 5 weeks and kept his real identity a secret. Then one evening, he was told to get into a minibus with other pickets.
I was ushered towards the back of the minibus. Instead of starting the engine, the leader of our group sat behind the wheel and motioned to the others to lock the doors, which they did. And it was at that point I started thinking this was slightly strange. And I remember he just turned his head round and stared at me. And everyone was looking at me suddenly. And he asked a question. We have information that you are not who you say you are, that you are a reporter from the Sun newspaper. And it was the moment, obviously, I had always dreaded. And it was pretty uncomfortable. The next 20 minutes was full-on, non-stop questioning and re-questioning of my story. They decided they would have a vote as to whether to let me go or whether to take me to this regional NUM HQ where they said people were waiting for me. And they made it clear that what would happen to me was that I would be taken around the back and beaten up badly, if not killed, frankly. There were 9 of them. I won it, 5-4, to let me go.
Richard Ellis fled back to the Sun's London offices and his editor, Kelvin McKenzie.
Kelvin was bouncing up and down and loved it. He wanted it there, then, right, start writing. He virtually dictated the intro to me, which was something, you know, I've just spent the most terrifying 5 weeks of my life and just carry on from there, he said. And so I did.
Richard Ellis revealed the violence of the hit squads, but it didn't deter men from returning to work. By the end of January 1985, half the workforce, 80,000 miners, had gone back. The strike was crumbling.